everyone. Thanks for listening. And just a little editorial note before we begin. After a few tumblers of vodka LaCroix, not LaCroix, LaCroix, and several Moscow mules, Moscow, there's no cow in Moscow. After a few Moscow mules, Jesus. I mean, I know we're not supposed to say Moscow. Moscow mule. Okay, yeah, but, so Matt and I set out to record episode 2 of this fine show. I entered thinking the subject would be, Ron and Russell's bios. He was under the impression that we would be talking about their first album. I'm not sure we did either of those things. But no matter, we'll get to those subjects later. For now, we will call this episode Matt's Sparks Experience. Enjoy.
All I do now is stick around. All I do now is stick around, dick around.
Welcome to episode 2 of Dicking Around with Sparks, where we discuss all things Sparks and the Mael Brothers. My name is Matt.
My name is Ted.
And we are your hosts of this week's episode. Now, last week, Jen was our host and talked a little bit about the introduction, each of hers and Ted's introductions to Sparks. This week, we want to talk a little bit about their first album, Half Nelson, or should I say Half Nelson renamed the Sparks, or...
Yes, but first, your introduction.
Oh, okay. Well, my name is Matt, and I am a Salt Lake City resident who got turned on to Sparks about 10 years ago, and... Some people started at the beginning, some at the middle, some more recently. Much like Ted, it was around the same time, but I believe a little bit earlier. I worked with a man who was our IT guy at the nonprofit organization that I worked at. It was heavily into dance music, remixes, and whatnot. He was aware of my sense of humor and a lot of the music that I liked from the 80s, 70s, and early 90s. This was kind of individual that listened to a lot of New Order, Psychedelic Furs, and when I made it clear that I liked the Smiths, he brought up something about Sparks and the song Lighten Up Morrissey, which led to him creating a burned CD for me of some of their albums around the 80s, 90s, and I specifically remember the song I Commit. I remember the album...
I Predict.
Yeah. Yes, that was one of the first songs, and I wasn't impressed off the bat. I had so much to go through. I mean, there was so much stuff in the 80s, and that was just one that I kind of lumped in with the others. But, you know, I knew by the titles, by some of the lyrics, that there was something to it, and I had eventually reconnect a year or two down the road with Ted, listening to Come On to My House front to back, as well as understanding
propaganda,
of course, propaganda, and the connection with the Mike Patton connection with Sparks I believe it was 2010 in Hollywood. Faith No More was playing one of the reunion shows, and they brought out Sparks on stage. And during that show, they featured Dean Menta, who toured on the King for a Day, Fool for a Lifetime tour for Faith No More. Even though that album was recorded, but the guitars on that album were recorded by Trace Bronze and Mr. Bungle.
Oh, yeah.
It was Dean Menta, John Hudson was out there, and Ron and Russell. And I think at that point, I was kind of like full speed ahead, like, this is wonderful, so now I need, where do I go from here? And so, that was kind of my introduction, was the Faith No More connection, as well as, you know, I'll give credit to Sean, the individual who had the four so tracks, which was that little taste of honey. So that, combined with, you know, Ted's affinity and what he'd been saying about Sparks, about his recent discoveries and what had been going on, and kind of.
So he exposed you to, like, kind of that novelty era of Sparks. They got goofy in the 80s.
Yeah.
Jen and I talked about this in the last episode. She loves all of it. That's my least favorite time. But that was your first exposure, like...
It was. And granted, at the time, I mean, there was a lot to deal with. I don't want to say I was completely naive, but I had not even listened to Pill at that point. I didn't know Big Audio Dynamite. I knew the bands before these, so I was still getting my education on a lot of music, but it was that the lyrics, I think, that really drew me in. And one thing that he told me, and I don't know if this is true or not, that they actually pretended to be a British band for a while.
Yeah, they were, what's the word? Anglophiles.
Anglophiles.
So they moved out to England. They had a stint there during their island years. Propaganda, Kimono, and the one after that.
Yeah, those were some good years. I mean, you look back on their catalog, and everybody has their favorites, and it's interesting to read the stories of people that had the 8 tracks, or they were looking for certain covers. I'm curious if the British people thought that Ron and Russell were just having a laugh, which, according to the British people, correct me if I'm wrong, that means they're joking around.
Yeah.
Were they kidding
taking
around?
Taking a piss?
Having a laugh, same thing. And I think in a lot of ways they were. There was a lot of humor that was not laugh out loud, ha ha, funny, but the joke would come to you a second or two later, and it would be a little combination of satire, a little farce, but the musician...
Acerbic wit.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
That's a good way of putting it.
I mean, holy shit. We'll get into lyrics later, but man.
It was something else. I mean, and it's hard to believe for me to get my head around... You know, back to the first album, 71, this is a time when, are we on the front end of the Vietnam War? We have Led Zeppelin still cranking out albums at this time. A lot of the Brit Invasion, the work they did with Todd Rundgren and the band. You know, the 70s were a very exciting time for music.
Oh, Golden, Bowie.
David Bowie, T-Rex.
Roxy Music, Genesis. Pink Floyd, God.
Queen, you name it.
And I had no idea. We went over this in the last episode, but I had no idea they went back into that era. And again, not to put too fine a point on it, but just blows my mind. They were back there, and they weren't just this goofy 80s band.
Yeah, I mean, is that, when you're the Mael brothers, did they know something? Did they know that being in another country, that people would be a little more receptive to that music? Because, I mean, Zappa has always had a following worldwide.
Yeah.
But Sparks in the U.S., not so much on the front end. I mean, you could even say now, they play in, New York, California, they play the coasts, a couple shows in between, but something resonated with them, with people on the other side of the world.
It's funny you would bring up Zappa. I think both the outfits, the humor in their music, both of them are just spectacular. Like Matt Groening, the Simpsons.
Yeah,
he talks about Zappa in terms of, well, if you're an artist, you're good at one thing, and Zappa was a fucking phenomenal guitarist and a fucking phenomenal social satirist. And I think you got the same thing going on with Sparks.
Yeah, which is I don't know if it's a chemistry thing. I mean, it could be something of the brothers. It's the genes. I don't know if there's something working off one another. Zappa just had, you know, musicians coming and going. And for Sparks, it's always been the same way.
Yeah.
And if you look back, especially the first album, I mean, the Mankey Brothers, I'm not even sure how that connection even came to be.
I'm not either. I've tried to do some research. You know, you go on to Wikipedia and what can Wikipedia tell you about anything? I mean, if you read a Wikipedia article to the Males and asked them how accurate it was, I bet it would come in at under 20% or so, you know.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
And you know, the beauty of, you know, a lot of people in the Sparks community is, you know, we know there are people out there who can either refute or confirm these claims. And there may be some folklore to all this.
Yeah.
You know, you think of bands that, you know, certain artists that use different names or profiles or pseudonyms. And, you know, with Sparks, it's, you know, it always keeps you guessing. It always keeps you smiling. And, I mean, that's kind of the beauty of this is, you know, as we're trying to bring it to light. And, you know, and kind of speaking of the first album, I think that might be a good transition into our contest from last week.
Yes, nice segue.
So.
But let me take a little drink here real quick. I might edit this out. I might not.
Okay. I will do the same.
That was actually a big drink. Okay.
All right.
Yeah, last week we had a trivia contest, and the question was, Sparks and Concrete Blonde, what is the connection? And the first person to email us was Juanita?
Juanita L. from Chicago, Illinois.
From Chicago. And she got it right. She pointed out that Mr. Mankey, is it Earl Mankey?
Yes.
Earl Mankey on guitar, founding member of Sparks. And after he departed Sparks, he went on to form Concrete Blonde. And if you listen to guitar solos on Sparks' first album and guitar solos on Concrete Blonde, there's no denying that's the same guy. It's beautiful. He's a great musician.
I think there's a reason why he's had a career that spans several decades.
Yeah.
When I first heard that question, I automatically jumped to the early 90s and was thinking there's got to be something with Point Break, the movie with Patrick Swayze and Keanu Reeves, because Concrete Blonde had a song in that.
There was always
something about that song that stuck out to me. I don't know what it was. I don't know if it was the name of the band, or if it was something that was tucked away in my subconscious. But I think, you know, once I heard some of the songs on Half Nelson and the guitar particularly, I knew there was something special about this band. It wasn't just, you know, he wasn't fighting for a solo. He wasn't trying to play over Ron's, you know, piano, his compositions at all. And for me, you know, the first song that I really liked was a Russell song, and it was because of the guitar by Earl Mankey called Roger. And if you listen to it, I still can't tell if it's a synthesizer, a sitar, some sort of modified acoustic, electric, hybrid combo. Yeah, it's you know, I can't really compare it to anything.
Yeah. Well, we'll get into it in the next episode, their first album. On Roger, the first album was produced by Todd Rundgren at the beginning of his fantastic career. And, you know, like in interviews, he's like, yeah, I was just kind of freaked out by these guys. And one day they're out in the back of the studio and plucking springs on a thrown away mattress and recording it. And that went into Roger. There's like these sound effects. Boing,
wow.
Boing. Yeah.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
Why am I not surprised? but somehow they made it sound like actual instrumentation. Like, yeah. Somehow they could take a broken mattress and tune it, almost make it sound like a fine-tuned instrument.
Yeah.
You know, to me, you know, the imagery that comes up when I hear a lot of that is, you know, I think the word that describes it is very whimsical music.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think of all the bands that I've, you know, enjoyed through the years, and they've always, I mean, not to keep going back to Zappa, but he definitely had a lot of whimsical, fun elements to his songs.
Zappa on Alan, what's his name?
Oh, the Steve Allen Show?
Steve Allen Show, mm-hmm. Playing the bicycle.
Yeah, that stuff is absolutely hilarious, and that's, I mean, that's black and white, and he's doing these things, you know, the crowd is laughing. And this is a Zappa that very few people know about. I think generally speaking, if you were to go, you know, to the record store, someone would talk about Joe's Garage or, you know, maybe some of his classical work or what he did in the 70s. But, you know, you got to remember that he was experimenting on the Steve Allen Show with a bicycle. And I think Steve Allen was a little freaked out by the whole thing. You know. All right. So we are to the point of talking about the Sparks YouTube recommendation for this week.
Oh, nice. This is a good one.
Now, Ted, tell me a little bit more about the song, Get in the Swing.
Well, the song is a good song, but all I can take away from it is Russell Mael in Tight, Tight Shorts.
It's quite a spectacle. I mean, the song standalone, you know, listen to it on vinyl, see, you know, digital, whatever format's great. But this video with an introduction from the Bay City Rollers drummer, whatever his name is,
I was a fan.
Okay.
In 1975, my Kiss fan buddy stopped being my friend because I liked the Bay City Rollers and Sean Cassidy.
That's not good. Wait, are the Bay City Rollers are from the Bay City, are they not?
No, they, when they were choosing a name for their band, they threw a dart into a map and it landed on some place called Bay City.
That's a little deceptive, but whatever. False advertising.
I don't know if that's true or not, but I think I read that in, what was the magazine back then? Jesus. It was a Teen Beat.
Teen Beat. Oh, I'm sure there's back issues out there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so there will be links to this video of our beloved Sparks playing Get in the Swing on some kind of Bay City Rollers variety show. Enjoy.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Like you said, Russell in the short shorts. We're talking
barefooted,
barefooted no less. This is just a wild guess, but I'm saying if this was 74, 75 ish, this was around the same time that Bjorn Borg was taking over the tennis world with his short shorts.
Oh,
now the big difference is
the connection is made.
The degrees of separation are very limited. You know, Bjorn Borg was blessed with good looks. Russell, on the other hand, had the musical talent, but he had crooked teeth and this permed look. And his brother, Ronald, probably weighed about 90 pounds at this point. Whether he had a tapeworm or not, you know, we can only speculate why he's so thin. But his shifty eyes, this video is just a great place to start if you're not familiar with, you know, the style, the sound of Sparks from the mid-70s, the early days, when they were really coming up outside of the United States, in the UK, in Sweden, in all these other countries.
And this is their third album in the Island Years. This is off of Indiscreet, and a lot of orchestration, a lot of big band and orchestra going on in the song, and just really intense and ahead of their time. Just, I'm going to stop saying just now. I say just too many times.
Well,
just Believe me, I'm going to stop saying just.
That's perfectly fine. And just to clarify, so on the...
Did you say just?
I did not say just, but there I did.
You said just to clarify.
Okay, now I said it twice. So, I can't think of another word to say other than that I'd like to take a step back. And the island year, so was propaganda the second of the...
Yeah, the island years was kimono, propaganda, indiscreet.
Okay, what a trifecta of awesomeness, those three albums.
Yes, oh my god. And we will get into that on future episodes. We'll cover their whole stint in the UK.
Absolutely. Now, let's talk a little bit about the bio of these brothers. You know, I know that the age difference is, I believe, Ronald's the older brother, born in 45.
45.
And it's Russell, funny, 48.
I was looking at some of the press material from the 80s, and they exaggerated the age.
Oh, really?
They had Ron as being 4 years younger than he was, and Russell the same, yeah.
Oh, I can see that. I can see that, why they do that, for marketing purposes and some other reasons as well.
Yeah. I'm not 50. I'm 18 years old. So are you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Everyone's.
It's a state of mind.
Yeah.
So, you know, as far as their childhood, there's so much, you know, like you said earlier with Wikipedia, the information could be 20% true of their upbringing. We know that they were raised in Southern California. Their father was some sort of designer, graphic designer, cartoonist for a newspaper or magazine in the area. Their mother was a librarian, but what was going on in the household from the time they were little kids to teenagers, we really don't know. That's...
I have no idea.
Yeah. It wasn't until, you know, art school and when they went to UCLA that the picture becomes pretty clear. But other than that, that's a lot of time that you'd like to figure out what was going on.
Yeah.
Were they listening to the Beatles? Were their parents listening to Elvis? Did they grow up on jazz? You know, we don't know exactly. Unless they've said it in some interviews, but from what I can tell, it's not public knowledge. A lot of, let's just say, the Mael brothers, anywhere from age 18 months to preteen.
I have seen a photograph, a yearbook photograph of Russell, and he was like the football team captain or the quarterback or something.
You've got to be kidding.
No.
Quarterback of the football team.
He's all decked out in his uniform and everything.
Wow. I can't believe it. I can see him. It's just, I really honestly can't believe it. When you say that, I think of some sort of blue blood. He's wearing a sweater with a Letterman jacket or something. You know, it blows my mind.
I mean, I'd be interested in knowing what his musical training was as an adolescent, as a teen. You know, arguably he's one of the greatest singers in rock and roll.
Yeah.
And, you know, did he hone his craft when he was young, or did he fall into this band with his brother and discover this amazing talent that he has?
I mean, who else was doing falsetto outside of rock and roll or jazz?
Yeah.
I mean, did he go to the opera? I mean, that's, you know, I wouldn't be surprised. Did he go to silent movies where they had the organist? You know, did that influence Ron somewhat? Yeah. You know, that's another thing. You know, in Los Angeles, I'm sure, you know, so many immigrants coming in that they were exposed to anything and everything.
Yeah, here's where we're calling out to Sparks fans to, you know, crowdsource what Sparks is, you know. Is there information to be shared? Can we glean some facts from the collective?
You know, I think that's a great idea. I mean, this will certainly help us connect the dots, solve some of these mysteries and theories that have been out there. And you read stories that, you know, so-and-so says, I helped them load their equipment in their first gig in this city. Well, it could be true. It could be folklore. But, yeah, let's open it up and see what people have to say.
Yeah, we've already had some nice responses from the first episode, and we're hoping to get even more. So everyone, please participate.
And we extend a great gratitude, you know, to all the Sparks fans who are listening and supporting this podcast. I mean, without you, we would just be
couple dickheads in Salt Lake City.
Yeah, just making it up and having no idea what we're talking about, which, you know, I'll still admit, you know, I don't know. I'm making a lot of this up, not as a fabrication, but doing the best that I can because we're dealing with several decades worth of music that has not been well documented, and I think we'll uncover some gems along the way.
I hope so.
So, as a reminder, we do encourage everybody to submit comments in the field on our page. We welcome suggestions, what we can do to make this podcast better, what you'd like to hear, other topics, and down the road, we have plans to talk to some previous members of Sparks.
Hopefully, yes.
I would say for sure.
Really?
For sure. By the end of 2018, we will talk to someone who has played in Sparks as a member. Whether it's a hired gun that was there for a couple albums, whether it's one of the Mankeys, you know, somebody else. We're going to make it happen. So stay tuned. I mean, that's going to be like a gold mine. So we will let you know in advance when that's going to happen.
Yes.
So until episode three, we will continue to just be dicking around because that's you know, like Sparks says, that's all we do. You know? And we'll talk again in episode three. So yes.
Thank you for listening. Like this video. Subscribe to the channel and be a Sparks fan because there's nothing else anyone should be.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Signing off.
Until next time.
Bye bye.
Bye.
But all I do now is stick around. All I do now is stick around.